Kentucky's two wins came in 1922, and then again in 97 when Tim Couch directed an overtime victory for Kentucky in Lexington. Mac Jones, the one-time Kentucky recruit, made his way to Tuscaloosa, and now a little bit more attention on him, if possible, by the visiting fans. Alabama won the toss. They've elected to defer, so we'll see Kentucky first. Jordan, what's your key for Kentucky to have any sort of success today?
Well, you heard from Cole the names that are out. I just want to reiterate Chris Rodriguez, their best running back, had 149 yards on 13 carries last week, and then two of their tight ends. They love to do 12 personnel, love to have multiple tight ends on the field. So without those pieces, a lot of weight on the shoulders of Terry Wilson, both running and throwing the football. He's got to have a huge game.
Sophomore Will Reichard ready to get things going for Alabama. Zach Johnson, senior, back to receive for Kentucky. By all accounts, it is a perfect day for football in Alabama. Temperatures in the low 70s as the sun begins to dip behind the stadium. And Reichard has us underway at Bryant-Denny. Chance for a return for Zach Johnson. He takes it to the 15 before he gets hit and then out to the 20. Never before has a Kentucky quarterback won on the road at Florida, Tennessee, and Alabama. Terry Wilson has a chance to make history today. That Florida win came in 2018. 2019 missed the final 11 games with knee injury. And then he's been inconsistent up and down this season, but he does have that win against Tennessee. And last week against Vandy, Jordan, he was sensational.
Yeah, he was balanced, and this offense was balanced. He was efficient throwing the football, but again, he's got 4.4 speed at 6'3", 200. I want to see what he can do with his legs today. It's going to be important.
He's got A.J. Rose in the backfield to start this game. And Rose takes it on the first carry, takes it over the left side for a big gain and a first down on a pickup of 12.
And something to watch early, especially in this first 15. Offensive coordinator Eddie Grant wants to show a lot of different formations. Be prepared for unbalanced. Be prepared for bunch sets, tight ends moving around. Any way they can reset Alabama's defense, as you're seeing right here, and try to create confusion.
What will get in the way is the absence of their starting tight end, Justin Rigg. Keaton Upshaw takes his spot in a stack formation on the left side. Wilson hands it off to Rose again, who takes it straight ahead. Picks up a yard before he's surrounded by crimson jerseys. That'll set up second and nine. Talking with Eddie Grand, he said, we've got to avoid obvious passing downs and third and long. Alabama may not have a ton of sacks, Jordan, but they can get pressure on the quarterback.
Yeah, and that's really the goal, is to push them into passing situations. So big on first and second down. It's really important for Kentucky to get yards, get into third and medium, third and shorts. They can't live in third and longs.
On second and nine, another run play. It's Rose again. You mentioned the fact that they were that Chris Rodriguez, who had a monster game against Vandy, averaged 11 and a half yards a carry. That was the best for a Kentucky running back since Randall Cobb did it back in 2010. They do have Kavassier Smokeback, and he gives you a lot more experience, and he gives you a lot more explosiveness at the running back position. Brian Ray has entered the field for Alabama. He'd been out with injury lately. Empty backfield. Bad snap. Wilson has to fall on it, and Kentucky doesn't get the playoff. It's a loss of eight, as Drake Jackson, a one-time Alabama recruit, sent it wide.
And Kentucky goes empty here, and Alabama's actually going to bring pressure. So they're going to bring one more than Kentucky had to block. Even if it was a good snap, I'm not sure Terry Wilson would have been able to get the ball off in time. Something to watch when they go the empty set. Now Alabama has shown they're going to bring six.
It may seem minor in a game in which Kentucky is a 30-point underdog, but they're without their starting punter, Max Duffy, the reigning Ray Guy Award winner. And so Chris Goodfellow gets it off to Slade Bolton, who takes it back to the 45-yard line. 43-yard punt, 15 on the return. When we return, you'll learn a little bit more about Alabama quarterback Mac Jones. Well, Mac Jones played for legendary head coach Corky Rogers at Bulls School in Jacksonville. He also coached Baseball Hall of Famer Chipper Jones. But one-time Kentucky commit flipped to Alabama and started out as a scout team quarterback. Stories about that coming later in the broadcast. Once he finally got the chance to blossom into a starting quarterback, well, he has been nearly perfect. On first down, little misdirection, and lobs over the middle for a first down on the throw and a hurdle. And Alabama takes advantage on the way to a 34-yard gain to Billingsley.
Just a great example by Steve Sarkisian, the offensive coordinator of Alabama, of eye candy. You see the motion. You see the half roll in one direction and the throwback to the other. That's one way he steals eyes on the defense and creates openings for his receivers. Done such a good job of that all year.
Najee Harris is his running back, one of the best in the country, averaging nearly 6 yards a carry. Held below his average on his first touch as he picks up just one. Josh Pascoe with the stop for Kentucky.
And he runs behind tight ends, Billingsley over to the side. I had a couple guys tell me on this football team that he might be the most athletic player on this team. Consistency has not necessarily been his friend, but a lot of people believe he could be a big part of this offense down the stretch.
Kentucky playing without their starting middle linebacker, Jamin Davis, as Cole pointed out earlier. Here's a toss to Devontae Smith. It'll count as a pass, and it'll count as a big gain and another first down, a pickup of 16.
And anytime you see these jet sweeps go for chunk plays, there's got to be a good block, and there was a great block on the edge of the line of scrimmage here on the right side of your screen. Bam. Watch Najee Harris come back, peel back. He's able to get that guy, and that's how Devontae Smith is able to break contain and get outside.
Mentioned good block on the edge for his running mate, Devontae Smith, the senior, who returned to Alabama. Already first and goal for the Tide. Here's Harris bowling his way down to the two. Pascoe with another stop. That'll set up second and goal.
Watch already how much Devontae Smith is moving around. Motion on the last couple plays. They're moving him around a lot without Jalen Waddle on the field.
Harris again. Hit at the line of scrimmage. Maybe picked up a foot. Tyrell Asian was the first man there up from his safety spot.
And this is where the size of Kentucky and having Quentin Bohanna, number 95 right there, 360 pounds back in the lineup. Another guy, number 50, Mark Wolf. McCall will be 380 pounds. They got some beef up there. This is where it's got to pay off.
Bama answers with beef. Kendall Randolph in a tight end next to Forrestall. And Harris will walk through the hole for a one-yard touchdown run. Already his 15th touchdown of the season, coming in just game number 7, second only to Trenton Richardson in terms of great starts with scoring for Alabama running backs.
That's pretty unbelievable. I mean, we talk about Mac Jones and his Heisman conversation. You could easily put Najee Harris in that conversation. 15 touchdowns. He had 13 all of last year. And depending on how they win these games down the stretch, he might get himself back in that Heisman conversation.
Reichert's extra point is good, and Alabama's got a 7-0 lead. A 6-play, 55-yard drive took 2.5 off the clock for Alabama. They got short field position after the Aaron snap on Kentucky's third down play. Alabama's offense has been nearly unstoppable.
Yeah, and this is what Steve Sarkisian has done so well. He's adapted early in games. You see this one of the first plays of the game versus Georgia. Georgia has a built-in blitz versus that formation that Alabama showed. 3 plays later, Sark goes, okay, I'm going to make you do it again because I'm going to change that route that was open the previous time, and I'm going to make you pay. The best offensive coordinators, yes, they have good plans going into games, but the greatest offensive coordinators make great adjustments in game, and that's what Steve Sarkisian has done so well. The creativity, the eye candy, as I mentioned earlier, and then adapting his game plan early and often in game to create matchup problems.
He was highly sought after by schools to take over their head coaching positions last year. That will again occur for Sarkisian, former head coach at Washington and USC. Second kickoff already for Riker. Zach Johnson from about the 7. And he takes it out to the 27-yard line. Third down play is the one that stands out for Kentucky on their first possession, but they're undone by a minimal play on second down. The big blue line is what they call it, this fantastic Kentucky offensive line playing against a pair of opponents today, not just number one Alabama, but also their grief. They lost their position coach, John Schlarman, the former Kentucky Hawk conference guard, after a battle over 2 years with cancer. He had continued to coach this team right up until the very end. And so today, Darren Kennard, the right tackle, is wearing his number 65. Wilson on first down, able to fire across to the tight end, Keaton Upshaw. It's a pickup of 12.
Yeah, without Chris Rodriguez in the lineup, you're going to see a lot of A.J. Rose. You're going to see a lot of Kavassier Smoke as well. He's wearing number 22 in honor of Chris Oates today, but he's their most explosive back. Expect him to split him out wide, to motion him back, to move him around a lot, to find ways to get him the football.
Oates, of Kentucky linebacker, suffered a health incident over the summer, has not been with the team, had been confined to a wheelchair, showed up earlier this season for a Kentucky game as Smoke takes it for a big gain, and that's a pickup of 9.
And you see the burst there, right? I mean, Chris Rodriguez is much more of a physical runner at 225, still successful, but Smoke in this game, I think, is more important, and that's why without Chris Rodriguez, you're going to see a lot of him. That one cut, right? Getting vertical, the burst, the speed. That's how Ole Miss got after Alabama's offense, with backs that were smaller in stature but quick, that could get vertical. That's the recipe for Kentucky.
A couple guys on the offensive side from Alabama, Kavassier Smoke at the running back position, and Allen Daly Jr. at wide receiver. Give it to the running back, Kavassier Smoke again, who missed a couple games with a rib injury suffered against Ole Miss. Second possession for Kentucky, and they moved the chains a couple of times on the season. Nearly 7.5 yards a carry for Smoke.
And here's that big shift. Yeah, these big shifts that Eddie Grant loves. Watch how Alabama communicates and adjusts.
Josh Ali on the toss. Beautiful cutback, and he's got the numbers out to the sideline before he's shoved out of bounds by Jordan Battle. It's a pickup of 32. Beautiful design.
This is what Kentucky wants. They want to move late. They want to change the picture for Alabama. Alabama doesn't fully adjust up front, so it leaves one guy, that corner that just came into your screen for contain. He gets blocked. That's the only guy that's there, and Josh Ali is able to make him pay.
Yeah, big
see the movement inside there.
Nick Saban has talked about the fact that defenses are behind this season because they need the reps in front of them. Kavassier Smoke in a wildcat takes it straight ahead and picks up just a couple. There's also the thought, guys, that defenses this season, as basic as it sounds, are having a hard time simply getting lined up. Does Alabama try to do too much defensively with shifts and motions in front of them?
Well, I think at times, right? I mean, Nick Saban philosophically wants to be perfect and demands perfection. He demands that every single play. But when the picture changes and motion happens right before the snap, if you're trying to be too perfect, you're not going to be aligned right. So that's the balance that Pete Golding is trying to implement. Simplify enough to still be stout, but not hinder your players.
Movement up front from Alabama. There's the flag. Wilson on the wheel route is able to find Kavassier Smoke, who carries it for a first down. Daniel Wright with the tackle. It'll be a gain of 11. It looked like Alabama jump on the interior.
Tom, I thought it was interesting talking to Nick yesterday just about defense as a whole, right?
And Williamson, our referee.
We've seen a lot of offense in this league, obviously, more so than ever. And Nick made an interesting point. He said, look, offenses, you know, with a limited offseason, they can go out and run plays on air and do everything they need to. Defenses can't. It's a reactionary position. You need an offense. You need movement. You need a play to respond to. So defenses naturally are a little more behind this year, I think, because of the uniqueness of this offseason and limited time.
I thought it was interesting, Jordan, actually wrote that quote down from Nick Saban. He said, you can't do a damn thing on defense versus air. He said, the offense can actually make that progress during this past off season that we had. And I haven't heard it stated as simply as Nick Saban put it. You've heard people say, well, you're not able to work against game speed. You're not able to get the same kind of reps, or it's not as physical of an offseason, therefore that's affecting tackling. I think those things are true as well. But the way that Nick Saban said it and stated it to us, I thought laid it out perfectly as to why a lot of the defenses, not just in the SEC, but in college football, are struggling this season.
I'm going to go to review to double-check the spot, see if it was indeed a Kentucky first down. 12-yard gain on the pass to Kavashe Smoke. Take a look at Kavashe Smoke's knee at about the 8-yard line. And did it get down? Looks like it did.
Yeah.
And would be short of the first down marker.
Good job by Dylan Moses playing out in space just to get enough of him there.
Mitchell Wilkins, a replay official, caught that one.
When a game like this, the red zone is so important for Kentucky, right? I mean, you know in the back of your mind that you're going to have to keep pace with an offense that's probably going to put up some points today. So you can't be thinking, play it safe down here. You can't be thinking 3 points is okay. You got to get six. You got to get seven touchdowns every single time you're in the red zone here for Kentucky.
Ruling on the field is ball spotted at the 3. That will probably back him up to the 8 after the review. And then Kentucky will have the opportunity of accepting the offside penalty. We'll leave him second and three, after the penalty. Instead of 3rd and 1.
After further review, the runner was down at the 8-yard line, short of line to gain. However, Kentucky will accept the penalty for offside. It'll be 5 yards from the 17-yard line, where it'll be second down.
Mark Stoops has a familiar face on the other side of the field. Mike Stoops is an analyst on the Alabama football staff. His brother and the Stoops family and Nick Saban go back a long way. In fact, Nick Saban recruited Mark Stoops to Michigan State back in the day. Talking to Stoops about it this week, he said, listen, my brothers went to Iowa. I was probably going to Iowa anyway. The Youngstown plan and the Stoops plus the Bellinis spent a lot of talent out in college football. See if they got the clock right. Second and 3 here.
Something to keep an eye on here. Alabama is going to go with no safety.
15-yard line. The penalty will be enforced to the 10. The second down.
It looks like Alabama is going to go no safety here. And you got Josh Ali at the top of your screen in the slot route in man-to-man cover. That's Kentucky's best receiver. They go play action here, maybe try to hit something behind this group of 4 linebackers for Alabama.
Here's Smoke trying to find the edge, looking for a block, and he barrels his way. We got another flag before he's taken down by Jordan Battle, and a pickup of 9.
Holding on the offense, number 67. 10-yard penalty from the previous spot. Repeat second down.
Left tackle Landon Young flag.
That is a critical error, and Landon Young's one of their best up front. This is not something you usually see, but down inside the 2-yard line. Let's see it on the right side of your screen there. Yep. Brian Young just tries to get away, and as soon as that defender steps to get away as an offensive lineman, you gotta let him go. It's so hard to do.
It's that strike and shed Pete Golding was telling us about. He wants to see more out of his defensive lineman. An excellent job to get the flag there.
Here's Kentucky with a 2nd and 12. They'll empty the backfield. 5-man rush to the slant. And that's complete to Josh Ali for a pickup of 5. Kentucky's been waiting, Jordan, for another wide receiver to step up. Alabama's got an embarrassment of riches at the position. Kentucky, not so much.
No. I mean, there's one receiver with over 100 yards on the season. It's crazy, and that's Josh Ali. You know, the tight end, Keaton Upshaw, has been a bright spot at times. But they got to find a number 2 that can make some plays down here, because especially in the red zone, all attention is on number 6, Josh Ali, right here in the slot at the bottom of your screen.
A.J. Rose back in the game at tailback. Pressure coming. Wilson going to the end zone. Too strong, aiming for Ali, and incomplete. Coverage by Malachi Moore, who's been a revelation defensively here in his first season.
This is a really good job by Josh Ali to actually get outside, because Alabama defender here playing on his outside shoulder. Really good move to get outside of Malachi Moore, and then that ball, oh, I mean, that's so close. I'm not sure if Ali didn't see it, or I'd love for him to lay out there.
It leaves Matt Ruffalo with a 33-yard attempt. Ruffalo is not available for the Vandy game. Chance Poor took over the kicking duties there. Ruffalo back in his starting spot. And he lines it through to get Kentucky on the board. One thing accomplished for Kentucky, they have shortened the game already. Only 5 minutes and 19 seconds left in the first quarter. Number one, Alabama with a 7-3 lead.
SEC Network Football is presented by Farm Ridge. Grab a snack.
Well, they've had some sensational wide receivers over the years at Alabama. Julio Jones, by the way, asked this week about the Falcon-Saints rivalry. He said, that's a good rivalry. The Iron Bowl is crazy. And a crazy amount of talent moving on from the wide receiver position. How's Devontae Smith fit in with what they've been historically?
I mean, he's every bit as good as anybody that they've had. You know, we did a little Mount Rushmore of Alabama receivers today on SEC Nation. I had Julio Jones, Amari Cooper, Devontae Smith, and I put Jerry Jeudy up there. I was kind of sticking to guys that I've seen play, but he is right up there in the conversation, obviously, with a chance to break the touchdown record today and eventually, I believe, the yards record for Alabama in a career.
Chance Poor with a kickoff. It'll be a touchback. Here's what's at stake for Devontae Smith, tied for the Alabama career record, 31 career touchdowns. That's also an SEC record that is shared by our very own Chris Doering.
Hey, I just want to say props to Roman Harper for getting David Palmer on his Mount Rushmore today. That greatness has been forgotten, and it definitely should not be. When the deuce was loose, man, there wasn't a better football player in college football, in my opinion.
Todd McShay has him second behind LSU's Jamar Chase. LSU pulled out a victory on the road at Arkansas today. Najee Harris joins Mac Jones. Jones looking for Harris out of the backfield, and nobody is there. An Alabama first down and more, and he spins his way to the 50. 25-yard gain.
And think about this, with Kentucky not having Jamin Davis, their leading tackler, and Mike linebacker, this running back position is going to be a focal point for Alabama, right? You got the experience out of there. That's how a running back gets lost on the outside, especially in zone coverage. Those linebackers got to bump over. They got to recognize that. They got to expand to it. But when you don't have starters out there, you're missing a guy like Jamin Davis. Plays like that are going to happen.
Marquez Bembry has taken his spot. Meanwhile, Tyrell Asian is injured. Starting safety coming off of a career-high game against Vanderbilt. They're tending to Asian's neck. They're already without another safety. Taj Dotson was ruled out today before the game.
Well, Tom, to complicate that even further, you mentioned Taj Dotson being out. The free safety in front of him, Yusef Corker, Coach Stoops told me before the game that he might have to play some will linebacker for this defense today because of Jamar Watson maybe having to go over to Mike linebacker. So shuffling a lot of pieces around in the third and second levels of this Kentucky defense today.
Andre Mosley will go in for Asian. They had a hard time bringing down 230 pounds of running back in Najee Harris. He'll give it to him again. Harris slips one guy. And one of the best in the country at evading tackles, he's able to pick up two off of nothing. Harris is top 10 in the country in missed tackles at 31%. The NCAA average is 21%.
You know, I thought it was interesting speaking with Kentucky defensive coordinator Brad White. You know, we asked, what do you try to stop first? And you would think with Mac Jones, the Heisman conversation, the high-flying plays downfield, he's like, no, we got to stop Harris because everything runs through him. The play action runs through him. If we can slow that down, we can hopefully limit those shot plays off play action.
And they do that here, able to get in the backfield for a big-time stop. It's J.J. Weaver, redshirt freshman from Louisville.
He also said Harris reminds him of Adrian Peterson. I mean, is there a higher praise from a defensive coordinator than saying that guy is like AD all day, baby? And he might be. He might be right. Najee's special.
Third down 10. Mac Jones on a crossing route has it incomplete. Threw it behind the intended receiver. He's trying to find Devontae Smith. And Wright was in there to make a play.
And this is something to keep an eye on, right? Kentucky plays traditional zone covers. They want to play back deeper than the deepest guy for Alabama. So they're going to try to keep everything in front. Those are the type of plays that Alabama needs to hit, getting Devontae Smith the ball in space, Mechie, Slade Bolden the ball in space. But if they knock a few of those down, if those linebackers start playing better in coverage, those shots aren't going to be there downfield.
Drew Kobayashi punts it away, and it will kick into the end zone, a 51-yard punt and a touchback for Kentucky's offense. So Mac Jones and the Tide come up empty on that possession, 7-3, Alabama leading.
Golden boot, gentlemen.
All right, Dari, thank you. Terry Wilson and Kentucky. With 3.5 minutes to go in the first quarter, quarterback will keep it and take it to the outside for a gain of 7.5 on first down. Daniel Wright with the stop. We mentioned this earlier. Kentucky, its entire football program, and really all of Big Blue Nation, with a heavy heart over the last couple of weeks. John Schlarman, their longtime offensive line coach, wore number 65 during his playing days at Kentucky as an all-conference offensive lineman, passed away after a battle with cancer. They had a memorial service for the team and for others. And Mark Stoops was very complimentary of the job that the school did on putting on the memorial service. Here's A.J. Rose with a big gain. Passes a 40 and a pickup of 15. And they honored him for the first snap of the Vandy game. They came out in a missing man formation. Schlarman played left guard. That spot was left empty. And then Landon Young honoring him by wearing his number 65. This was the offensive line saluting his family in the suite after the game. Darren Kennard is wearing number 65 today. Cole, we'll get into that story here. It is almost unthinkable that not just the offensive line, but everybody in this Kentucky program dealing with loss in the midst of a season and battling forward.
But you could talk to a lot of people on this staff about what he meant technically, fundamentally, teaching, coaching the offensive line position. He was very involved with the run game as well. Certain members of that staff will tell you that his eyes were very valuable during the course of a game, seeing what a defense would do. But it's the human being that's missed more than anything else, how he molded some of these lives and how he began to take a fathership position with a lot of these players on this football team. Drake Jackson telling us that he didn't know they were going to leave that left guard position open in the first play against Vanderbilt, and actually broke down and cried when he looked to his left and saw that it was vacant.
Wilson on second and 9 goes to the slant to Ali. Drake had a great story about that first play. He said, "We have so much respect for the Vandy defenders. They clapped, they applauded. They said, listen, we prayed for you guys all week, and we feel for you." He said, and then on the first drive, we all came out and put them in the turf. He said, we just buried these guys. He said, I felt kind of bad. They were so sensitive to what we've been through, but we had so much emotion that we were ready to go. Jackson makes his 41st consecutive start at center for Kentucky today. Pitch to Kavassie Smoke. Picks up just one, second and 9 coming up.
And it was a different week of practice for Kentucky. Obviously, the emotions, the grief. Stoops even mentioned, he said, you know, it was weird. Monday, we went no football. That's really abnormal. The memorial was there. Tuesday, just hats. Tuesday is usually a hard-working day. So you'd wonder how this offensive line was going to come out. I tell you what, they're moving Alabama up front right now. They're getting great push, playing inspired football. And look at all the movement that you continue to see from Kentucky causing Alabama to adjust every single play.
And we have a flag in the play. It looked complicated what Kentucky was doing because he had 12 men on the field.
You got to try that every once in a while, right?
Right. Not cheating unless you get caught.
What if you get away with it?
Offense, more than 11 players in the formation. 5-yard penalty remains second down.
You saw there was some confusion when they split wide right.
But listen, I mean, that's the thing. Eddie Grant is going to change a lot of personnel groups, a lot of different formations. And when you do that, guys are running in and out all the time. And communication has got to be at a premium for Kentucky. And Yeah, it looks hard to look at. Alabama's like, wait, they got three guys on this side and three on that side. Wait a minute, what? Yeah, that's 12.
Ole Miss's tempo gave Alabama a real hard time early in the season. They'll mark this one off and leave Kentucky with second and 13. And while Kentucky doesn't do tempo, Mark Stoops stressed that. He's like, that's not who we are. They can get Alabama out of position by the shifting in motion. Trips to the right for Terry Wilson. Play action. Wilson has time. He's going to go deep against this Alabama secondary, and it's overthrown, but a flag. Patrick Surtain had the coverage on Allen Daly Jr. Pardon me, DeMarcus Harris, who came down
for targeting. There was a lot of confusion for Alabama trying to get aligned to that set, a lot of communication. So it was a good setup for Kentucky to take a shot, and big collision at the end of that one.
And Williamson again.
Personal foul, hands to face, defense number 47. That penalty will be declined. Pass interference, defense number 28. That penalty will be enforced in the previous spot. 15 yards, automatic first down.
Josh Job draws the flag. I don't know if it was a contact as much as it was Harris going to the ground hard. Another
look
right
at
here.
Double coverage. Great job by Terry Wilson just giving his guy an opportunity, right? You never want to overthrow this. And, yeah, that's why I said I thought they might look at this one for targeting. Look at Josh Job here. It's a defenseless receiver going up. But either way, it's early contact.
Oh, from that angle, yeah. Even more obvious.
And it may not have been forcible enough for them to take a look at that. It's got to be forcible. There was a glancing blow with the helmet, but.
Here's Keaton Upshaw on the run. And he picks up a Kentucky first down, down to the 20. Impressive drive so far for the Cats, playing catch up behind number one Alabama. Their last drive lasted nearly 5 minutes. It took a lot of time off the clock, and this one following the same script into the first quarter. Top teams have had their handful in first halves today, and Alabama in the same boat. Time of possession rarely matters in modern college football. It might be a key today if Kentucky's able to pull the upset. Dylan Moses, starting linebacker. Pete Golding, the defensive coordinator. Interesting discussion with Golding about Moses and whether or not he's playing fast enough.
We've already seen Kentucky with a lot of the unbalance, the movement pre-snap. So it's on the shoulders of Dylan Moses to get everybody lined up. And Pete even said that's what he's doing best. But it's also a double-edged sword because he's so worried about the other 10 guys. He's not getting to his read keys quick enough and playing as fast as they'd like him to. So watch that as it evolves, because one quarter in, Pete Golding even said, early on, we're going to play simple. We're going to see what their tendencies are, what they want to get to unbalanced. These explode to motions to empty sets. And then we're going to have our plan. So starting now, you're going to start to see the plan for Alabama and Dylan Moses and see if they can ramp up how fast they're adjusting.
So it's twofold. It's not just what Kentucky's doing, but it's also what Dylan Moses has been doing all season. Pete Golding said he worries so much about his teammates, getting them in the right position, making sure they understand the call and communicating to everybody. It has slowed his game down, and we can't have that. He's got to be running full speed every play. And right through Moses goes A.J. Rose for a pickup of 7. Christian Harris ended up on the tackle.
And put your mind into the middle linebacker. You got to set everybody up. You see Dylan Moses there right over the hash. And then you have two keys. You have a primary key and a secondary key. So if you're worried about everybody, at the last second you look back to your primary key, well, then they move, or it's to your secondary key, you're late. You can't win if you're late playing on defense. So the simplification of the defensive scheme by Pete Golding has hopefully allowed Dylan to play faster. But again, Kentucky having their way with these motions.
Preseason first team all-conference linebacker Dylan Moses on first and goal. It's Rose again, who hesitates before he gets past the line of scrimmage for just a yard to Darian Mathis, and on the stop for Bama.
Jordan mentioned those unbalanced sets. Pete Golding told us Kentucky ran 18 snaps of unbalanced against Tennessee. And in the offseason study they did, said we saw an abnormal amount of non-traditional formations against our defense. That includes unbalanced formations into the boundary, tempo, things of that nature, and said that he feels like the unbalanced looks from Kentucky will be what they are for the game. Going back to what Jordan said, the adjustments should be beginning to set in now for this Bama defense.
Nico Genovich has checked in at tight end on the right side. Little playing time for Genovich this season. Terry Wilson pulls it back, looking in zone, will fire a bullet, and it is incomplete for Ali, covered by Patrick Surtain. And that's going to leave Kentucky with a third goal.
Boy, this matchup on the outside is going to be a tough one for Terry Wilson and Josh Ali. Alabama just so good on the outside with Surtain, with Josh Job. I feel like these routes has got to either go across the field or they got to be double moves, whip routes. You can't just run into Surtain and expect to beat him one-on-one.
Now third and goal for Kentucky.
Watch the tight end, 88 here, attached at the bottom of the screen. Keaton Upshaw, 6'7". That's a matchup Kentucky will like.
Kentucky uses a timeout prior to their 11th play of this drive. Kentucky down early, but threatening.
Noka with your AT&T 5G studio update. Out of the footprint we go. Number 7, Cincinnati, unbeaten on the year. At UCF, down 14-3. Just second game the Bearcats have trailed all year. Desmond Ritter to Josh Wiley, 29 yards. It's 14-10, Knights early second.
Hi, Donnie, thanks. Similarly, Alabama has only trailed in a pair of games this year, Ole Miss and Georgia. Kentucky threatening to make it game number 3 on the season. Pete Golding, the defensive coordinator.
Huge down here
for Terry Wilson.
Kentucky already left points on the board down inside the 10. Last drive.
Quarterback lead. Wilson hit in the backfield, and he picks up only a yard. He had smoke in front of him, but he had old big number 58, Christian Barmore, waiting.
Boy, and I said it in the break. I thought they might go empty quarterback draw. You leave a running back in the box, that leaves an extra linebacker in the box. But it didn't matter. Barmore just beat his man there. That's the thing, quarterback draw, you got to win the front four first. You're so worried about the linebacker. You got to win the front four first. And another huge blow to Kentucky to not get 6 inside the 10.
That Ruffalo has already made from 33. This is a 24-yard attempt for the senior, and the snap gets loose. Ruffalo's going to chase it down. And he falls on it right outside the logo. And another mistake in the exchange. Cade DeGraw, the long snapper, and their primary holder, Max Duffy, is unavailable today. It's Colin Goodfellow, the backup punter, who couldn't handle it.
Take a look at the operation here. It's a high snap. I mean, yeah, he's the backup holder, but that was hot and high. I've been a holder. I was a holder in college my entire career. That's the last place you want it. You'd rather have it trapped on your body, down near your knee, hot and high like that. You got no shot.
So not only does Kentucky fail to get points on the board, but Alabama will have great field position. Mac Jones wants a throw on first down. He finds Slade Bolden. A couple of yards for Bolden. Brandon Echols with the stop.
You can already see a few times now they've done these half rolls, trying to take shots down the field, and they're not there. Kentucky is playing zone over the top, deeper than the deepest. I said it before, that's Kentucky's philosophy. And right now, Mac Jones is just going to have to stay patient. Keep taking those checkdowns. And then give the ball to Harris to get him out of that zone.
It was a loss of 36 yards of field position on the failed snap. Jones to the sideline. On time for an Alabama first down. Jaleel Billingsley, another big play. This one goes for 28.
And take a look at the accuracy here of Mac Jones. Completing almost 80% of his passes on the year, 78.5. And watch the accuracy. Right in the window, right in stride. That's not an easy throw for a quarterback to make. It's not a traditional area. You're putting this on a line, but it's not over the top. It's right on the numbers. It's a great job allowing his receiver to catch and run.
J. Stones has started this game 3 for 4 for 74 yards. Play action again. Double move over the middle. And it's in! And no! Drop! Kentucky had two guys with a shot at it. First was Echols, and it looked like his teammate, Bembry, collided with him to knock it out of his hands.
And what did I just say?
Roughing the passer, contact to the head. Defense number 92.
That's another big penalty.
15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Wouldn't have mattered. Phil Hoskins with the flag.
Correction, half the distance.
Now you're going to see 92 come off right there. Yep. Hands to the face. They're going to call that every time. But again, I said, Mac Jones has got to stay patient. They dialed up 3 shot plays and back-to-back plays. An offensive coordinator can do that when your quarterback is not just throwing it to throw it. When he's checking it down, that time Mac Jones got a little greedy. And against this defense, second the SEC in interceptions and takeaways, you can't afford to get greedy and try to fit that ball into a window that's not there.
Mac Jones
bailed out because of the penalty.
Top 10 in the country in most offensive passing stats. He's got Bolden on the flat. He's going to turn, look for the wheel. That's covered up. And tries to go back to Bolden, who takes it down to the 11-yard line on a pickup of 3.
Alabama calls these protections hammer and nail. They're going to pull a guard out. They show you a gap scheme run. Gives Mac Jones a little bit more space to operate outside of the pocket. Puts guard in a tough spot, though. A lot of times you get out there in space against a defender that's a little bit more loose than you are, and he has room to operate. Can go inside, can go outside. It's a tough ask for an offensive lineman.
Fantastic offensive line. Paving the way. Jones on 2nd and 6. Great coverage by Kentucky. He's got nowhere to go. Try to thread the needle. And he sneaks it in. Devontae Smith. A record-setting touchdown grab from 10 yards out.
Wow. There it is. There's the record. And they really wanted to go to 6 early. He had a double move on the field side. And this is one of the most underrated aspects of his game, his ability to find the soft spot, right? You see the big plays downfield. You see the catch after the run. What you don't usually see is him navigating to find space, and that's what he did right there, mirroring his quarterback and finding space.
Snap infraction, offense number 45, 5-yard penalty, replay the try.
Thomas Fletcher, the long snapper, they'll do it again. Career touchdown reception number 32 for Devontae Smith. New Alabama record, a new SEC record. Liker bangs through the extra point. Alabama takes advantage of the bad snap on a field goal, short field, and Devontae Smith finds his way open. He waves goodbye to Amari Cooper and Chris Doran. 32 career touchdowns through the air for Devontae Smith. It's another record for Devontae Smith. This one not just an Alabama record, but also an SEC record. 32 receiving touchdowns. Here's how it played out.
Yeah, and I was wrong. It's actually a double move to Mechie, and Devontae's on a runoff route backside, but look at him work. He finds Mac Jones, puts his hand up, goes, come on, one-on-one, and what a throw. I mean, right on the money, moving to his left. Look at the back pedal, Mac Jones buying time. That is not an easy throw with a couple guys in your face exactly where he needed to put it.
All smiles for Mac Jones. Former child model. Will Riker kicks it off. Zach Johnson to receive. Another return opportunity for Kentucky. Johnson breaks through to the 30. Gets dragged down at the 35.
Almost a face mask there, I thought I saw. Either way, Kentucky's going to have a good field position.
Yeah, tough to see from the angle, but Joe brought him down by just a hand. And now Terry Wilson at quarterback. Terry Wilson nearly lost a job at quarterback at Kentucky. Here's a look at that replay and the kick return.
Yeah,
that is a face mask.
Mm-hmm. Should be 15 more yards for Kentucky.
So on the Thursday before the Vandy game, Mark Stoops walked into the quarterback room and said to Terry Wilson, you will start the game, but I will play all three quarterbacks, including the talented freshman Bo Allen, who's a big passer out of Lexington. Smith bottled up in the backfield and maybe a yard as Kavasi Smoke gets taken down. Talking to Mark Stoops at practice this week, he said, listen, I probably would have gotten Bo Allen in earlier, but Terry was fantastic. He got off to such a great start. He ended the Vandy game 13 of 15. One of the best performances in school history. So Bo Allen has the headset and the yellow penny on now. While Gatewood also waits with helmet on. I wouldn't be surprised if we see Bo Allen in this game.
I wouldn't be surprised if we see Gatewood either, maybe in a running situation. So, but right now, Kentucky moving the football, and Terry Wilson's doing everything right. Just got to keep it up on this drive.
On second and nine, a couple that time for Kavasi Smoke, and that will leave third and seventh. Wilson is a great runner, as you discussed earlier in this game, but Mark Stoops has on his hand a guy who's second in Kentucky history, only to Tim Couch, in completion percentage. And the all-time leading rusher quarterback for Kentucky for those who have thrown for more than 2,500 yards. They had a running quarterback slash wide receiver, Lynn Bowden, play the position last year. Wilson, off his back foot, fits this one in, and room for Isaiah Epps. Back to action, and Epps takes it for a first down.
Oh, it's good to have Isaiah Epps back if you're Kentucky. He's really the fastest guy they got there, and we talked about them needing a number two wide receiver to emerge. They'd love it to be 81 because of how dynamic he is down the field. And that time Alabama brought a little pressure, left man coverage on the backside, and Wilson was able to hold on to it long enough to find Epps.
A foot injury cost Epps all of last season. Out to Kavasi Smoke. And he's taken down in the open field for no gain. Great play by Malachi Moore. Cole, Malachi Moore has come almost out of nowhere to be a defensive star for Alabama.
Just a sensational story playing his high school ball at Hewitt Trustville for Josh Floyd, who told me that maybe changing positions was something that helped him a lot. He went from receiver to corner to safety. When Nick Saban was recruiting him, he talked about his instincts was really what they fell in love with during the recruiting process. He graduated early to enroll in January, and due to the numbers, he wasn't able to actually get into school then. Had to wait until the summer. Well, we know this wasn't a normal summer, so to be able to go through a COVID summer and still come in and play and contribute heavily as a true freshman in the Alabama secondary, beyond impressive.
Whistles before the snap. And Jordan, as we talked to Pete Golding
Kentucky
about it.
Second time out of the half.
It was all about who Malachi Moore is as a learner that allowed him to pick up everything Alabama wanted to do defensively for a guy who'd never taken a college snap.
Yeah, for a quick lesson, there's three types of learning: kinesthetic, auditory, and visual, right? Kinesthetic, you got to be there. You got to have it happen to you. You got to walk through it. That's how most football players are. That's how I was. And in the world of COVID this offseason, it was all visual and auditory, right? Through Zoom calls. That's really tough for a true freshman to not ever get to walk through it until fall camp. But he is a great learner visually and auditory wise. That's why he's on the field. He was way ahead of the game. By the time they actually set foot on campus and were allowed to practice, he was already ahead of the game, acting like a veteran, and that's why he's on the field. That's why he was able to make such a big impact early, and he's going to have a great career based on just the small sample size we've seen so far this year.
Couple of picks this season.
I was going to say, Tom, I love how Pete Golding said, you know, in those Zoom meetings, a lot of guys are there, but they're not there.
Yes.
Malachi Moore was there every day.
I feel like that applied to you during our production call last night, Cole, via Zoom. Smoke and Rose in the backfield. Play action. Wilson chased. Try to find Smoke. And was incomplete.
You know, it's funny, Tom. I went back and Pete Golding told us, Jordan mentioned, those three styles of learning, auditory, visual, and kinesthetic. And I kind of wanted to do some research on them. And I thought to myself, man, I don't really think either one of these works for me. I think I need these plus some.
Like, what do you say?
Pete, what are the bonus ways of learning? Because I need those, too.
Pete Golding played his college ball at Delta State. Second season as Alabama's defensive coordinator. Third and 10.
Might be two-play territory. Wouldn't be surprised if we get a quarterback draw here out of this empty set.
11 sacks on the season for Bama. They bring four. Pocket holds, and out of the backfield they find the tight end. Here's Upshaw, who rumbles his way inside the 30, and a pickup of 14 before Sertan took him down.
Look, when you go empty, you vacate the middle of the field, and that's why I said maybe a quarterback draw could attack that. Instead, they leak their tight end on a delay route, right? He blocks it first, one, two, then delay releases to the middle of the field that's been vacated by that pre-snap motion. Great play design on third down, a huge third down for Kentucky. Great job by Eddie Grant, their offensive coordinator.
Second catch of the season, of the game for Upshaw. Second string behind Rigg, who's unavailable today and didn't make the trip. Two backs in the field continuously for Kentucky. Wilson pulls it back, lobs it down the sideline, incomplete. Trying to find Cavassier smoke out of the backfield.
Keep in mind when you're talking about Kentucky tight ends, this is a tight end heavy offense. You'll get a lot of 12, even some 13 personnel normally from Eddie Grant. Two scholarship tight ends made this trip for the Kentucky Wildcats, much fewer than they're normally used to playing with.
Yeah, that includes Nick Ojinovich. We've seen action early in this one. Kentucky's gone pass heavy for their offense. Five consecutive pass plays. Quarterback draw again, and Terry Wilson finds three. Jordan, you mentioned it earlier when they tried it near the goal line. Does it defeat the purpose of QB run when you have a running back next to him?
No, not always. No, the couple times they went empty, it vacated the middle of the field. That's why I thought maybe they would go back to that. It's pick your poison, right? If you leave somebody in there, you got an extra hat just in case Alabama doesn't adjust out. So it's not good or bad either way. It just depends on how Alabama plays it, and they've adjusted really well to that set.
Both third down conversions for Kentucky today have come on this drive. This will be the ninth play of the drive. Emma brings four. Wilson goes down the sideline. Incomplete. Josh Ali, the intended receiver, covered by Malachi Moore, who we've discussed is having a sensational rookie campaign with the Tide.
Interesting that they took a shot here. You know, third and eight.
Well, they bring out the field goal unit. This was to happen last time. 36 yards the wrong way.
Man, watch how fast that snap is. I mean, long snappers to take you inside the operation. You're not slinging it back there as fast as possible. It's got to have some juice to it, but it's got to be catchable.
Cade DeGraw, the snapper. Replaced Blake Best this season. It was a four-year starter. That was a wobbler, and they got the snap down, and it stays wide right from 42 yards. A knuckleball to Goodfellow. And special teams, an early disaster for Kentucky.
This is a nightmare, too, for a holder. Watch this. You love a spiral so you can catch it. These aren't receivers out there. That's a duck back to him. Doesn't get a chance to catch it clean and get it down, and another big missed opportunity for Kentucky.
Alabama with the lead. Mac Jones has started this game 7 of 8 through the air for 118 yards and a touchdown. And he will hand it off to Najee Harris, who picks up just one. Cole, we talked about the Kentucky offensive line. What makes this Alabama offensive line so special?
I think it's physicality. I think it's attitude. I think it's demeanor. Number one, they're huge. They're massive. I mean, I hadn't been able to see Landon Dickerson up in close personal for a while, but I'm on the field, and he's bigger than Alex Leatherwood. Like, in stature, he's just a bigger dude. Cornbread Brown's a big dude at left guard. Evan Neal is just a mammoth of a human being. They have the ability to push you around, and I think that physicality separates them from a lot of other groups.
Dickerson, the center, 6'8", 325. Jones completes another one. This to Devontae Smith, who already has a touchdown.
So a little bit of what's different from what Landon Dickerson has brought to this team happens actually almost after the play, at the end of plays. Finding work, as Landon Dickerson told me it is earlier this week. You're not going to find anybody else who gives the kind of effort towards the end of plays that Landon Dickerson does. Some people are going to call it dirty. I call it quality football. Landon Dickerson's a guy that brings that attitude and that demeanor. Nick Saban said it's been welcome for this football team.
From Hickory, North Carolina, started his career at Florida State. Jones going deep with man coverage and incomplete. Smith cover by Kelvin Joseph, boss man Fat. That's his name on the label. On the field, number one, the LSU transfer, football player by day, rapper by night.
When we spoke to Kelvin, I think he felt like this was one of the opportunities. Come from LSU to Kentucky, get a little bit out of the spotlight as a DB, right? Well, this was one of his opportunities to show out. He was looking forward to matching up against Devontae Smith, against John Metchie, some of these guys, to prove that he belongs.
Match up with Devontae Smith, 7-7s throughout the summers, one-on-one through camps. He's no stranger to what Smith can do. Here's Najee Harris. Big hole for Harris, who rips off a 14-yard gain.
That's really the biggest area of operation Harris has had today. I feel like Kentucky's front four is playing pretty well. That time they got washed out, lost contain.
How about this line? Off balance to the left with only one right guard. Harris hurdles, flag on the play to the 20, and a little bit of a stiff arm to the end zone. Touchdown, Alabama, if it stands. 42 yards for Najee Harris.
Legal substitution, defense, 12 players on the field to play when the ball is snapped. That penalty is declined. The result of the play is a touchdown.
A lot happening on this one. Second of the day for Harris.
And it was the tempo, right? A great job by Sark to call tempo. And look at the defensive line for Kentucky. There's a huge hole right there. They're not aligned the way they should be because of the tempo. They tried to substitute. They were out of position. And you can't be out of position against Alabama in number 22 because that happens.
Alabama went unbalanced to the left. And that was a big part of it. Najee Harris with some hand fighting at the end to keep the defenders at bay. It's the longest Alabama run of the season of 42 yards, and it came against 12 men. The last one dispatched with a hand to the face.
I'm reporting right around the corner, Dari Doring Chiswick. How Florida rolled in Nashville. LSU got one in Arkansas, a tight one. First half here, look, you handled it like a pro when Devontae got into the end zone and passed you.
I did. Congratulations to Devontae.
Congratulations to you. 25 years later.
25 years. All right, guys.
To Zach Johnson. Let's take a look at that touchdown run, Jordan.
I don't think we will. Sometimes I don't even.
Najee Harris showing congratulations to his offensive line for his 16th rushing touchdown leading the country.
Should go give a little fist bump to Steve Sarkisian, too, because look at this picture. What are you going to notice? There's no right tackle. Evan Neal is left tackle. Alex Leatherwood is outside of him. They go unbalanced to the left. Kentucky trying to substitute and not adjusting ends up being a touchdown for Alabama. Great design.
I'll tell you guys, that's the first time I've seen that overlooked from Steve Sarkisian as the Alabama offensive coordinator. I've never seen that look before.
The time to put it in, 21 days without a game for Alabama. After an off week and the LSU cancellation, first time they had back-to-back weeks off since 1978. A.J. Rose picks up three.
And a huge drive right here for Kentucky. Think about it. They had two field goals that, because of operation, are not on the board. It really very well could be 21-9 here. They've gotten down inside the 10-yard line twice. They got to get points out of this drive. They got to take some confidence into halftime because there's been parts of this first half where they've moved the ball and they've looked good. And there's been some critical errors that have cost them points off the board.
Special teams specifically. On 2nd and 7, Wilson has it batted up. Dangerous play. Kentucky is able to come down with it. Nearly an Alabama pick. Jordan Battle sent it in the air with the tip. His dad, a former professional basketball player, is a pretty good shot blocker back in his day playing in Honduras.
Yeah, watch the play. I mean, he's a football junkie. We talk to him. He's like, look, every time I go home, dad's recorded the games. I watch it. He breaks it down. Mom's there trying to tell dad to be easier on me. I mean, he grew up watching football. And those are instincts right there. You can't teach that. He sees the quarterback. He's reading it, gets his hands up, and almost turns it into an interception. But a great play there by Isaiah Epps to bring that down for Kentucky.
3rd and 4, four-man rush. Wilson to the slant, left it high. And incomplete. Daly covered by Surtain.
And that's not who Terry Wilson is. And that's not how Kentucky's been successful passing the football. I mean, we've seen flood routes. We've seen them vacate space and then attack that space. just lining up and throwing slants is not going to work against Alabama. They're too good on the outside. Eddie got a little bit away from the creative shifts, motions, overloads that got them some success early in the half.
Colin Goodfellow on to punt it away. Saw his first action in his career against Vandy. Here's Bolden. Backed up to the 26. 3 yards on the return after a 50-yard punt. Mac Jones, well-balanced coming out of Bulls school in Jacksonville. Not just a child model, but also speaks fluent Mandarin. And he played for one of the all-time greats, Corky Rogers, who was the head coach in Jacksonville at a couple different schools, but mainly Bulls for 45 years. Won 10 state championships and set the state record for wins. Passed away this past winter. He coached everybody from Leroy Butler to Hayden Hurst and Chipper Jones. On first and 10. Mac Jones flips it out. Here's Harris. Beautiful move by Najee Harris. Guys, we talked with Steve Sarkisian about Najee Harris's vision and how he's a different running back than he's been before. And he said a lot of that has to do with his workload.
Yeah, and Sark's a guy that traditionally has been more of a workhorse type offensive play caller. He wants one guy. He wants to make sure that it's cohesive, that he keeps him in there. Najee's built for it, but really the repetition and knowing he's going to get the volume of carries has allowed him to mature into that position.
Cordell Looney moved.
Offside, defense, number 59. The movement by the defense caused the offense to react. The penalty is 5 yards. It's second down.
So Looney out of the game. And when it comes to Harris's vision and ability, he said when he's only getting 5-6 carries a game, he felt like he had to make a big play every time he got a touch. Well, you're getting 25 touches a game. You get plenty of time. Take what they're giving you. And that's helped him blossom into perhaps the best running back in college football. Empty backfield on second and 2. Over the middle for the first down to Bolden. 8 of 9.
Tell you what, this is really only the second game plan that Alabama has had without Jalen Waddle. And I know it seems like so long ago that he got hurt, but he got hurt at Tennessee. Then they had one game where they planned without him. Slade Bolden's a guy that's going to continue to develop the more they design plays to get him the ball.
Jones trying to stay behind the line of scrimmage, flips it to Billingsley. Pickup of 16, going tempo now with 1:19 left in the half. Alabama trying to add to their total.
And this is where they're so dangerous because they have a veteran quarterback that understands the offense. He could probably call these plays on his own. He knows what Sark wants to go to. Now a Kentucky player down at the top of your screen there.
And so that'll slow Alabama's offense before Mac Jones got back behind center. An 11 of 13 start to this game for 164 yards. It's the veteran Kelvin Joseph, the LSU transfer, is getting stretched out.
And I tell you what, if you're Steve Sarkisian and you see number one down there with cramps, I'm thinking of taking a shot. And that might be what he's talking to Mac Jones about right now.
And for two reasons, right? I mean, anytime a defensive back goes down or anybody goes down with a cramp when the other team is looking to go tempo, the assumption is, well, they're just trying to stop our momentum. So why not attack that position specifically?
Yeah, and you never know. You know, is it gamesmanship? And is he just acting, or is it really a cramp? Either way, Kelvin's one of their best cover guys on the back end, and Alabama's got a few different guys that can take the top off. First and 10 here, still a minute and 12 seconds left, all timeouts. So if you're Alabama, you have an eternity. You can afford to take a shot and then come back and run the football on second down if you don't get it.
Keep an eye and see if number one returns next play. 1:10 remaining and rolling. Looking to the right side, back to the left. Jones now over the middle. Ball up in the air and incomplete. Off the hands of Devontae Smith.
Mac Jones really scanned the entire field here. Comes back to the middle. Yeah, and that's a ball that Devontae Smith should bring down. Kentucky defender does a good job of trying to split the hands, but that's one that you'd expect Smith to hold on to.
On second and 10, back to Smith. He stays in bounds and tightropes the sideline before taking a hit after the whistle. 22-yard gain. Vito Tisdale with the stop.
Just think about the state of this football game, you know, 6-7 minutes ago. Right? I mean, it was 14-3. Kentucky had missed a couple field goals. They've driven the ball consistently down. And now Alabama has a chance to go up 28-3. It looks like Kelvin Joseph back on the field. So a little Gatorade fixes everything, huh, Tom?
Indeed. It's a game that was 7-3 at the beginning of the second quarter. And now Alabama looking to further their advantage. Wide open. Down to the goal line is Mechie, and he's in for an 18-yard touchdown.
And they're going to fake a screen to the top right here. And watch Mechie. He's going to act like he's blocking, and then he's going to release up the field. Fake a screen to Devontae Smith, and look, takes two guys, and Mechie sneaks right into the vacancy, and the safety didn't have time to come over the top. I mean, that's the thing. A good receiver like Smith, he's going to make some big plays, but he's also going to make an opportunity for other guys to make some big plays.
A six-play, 71-yard scoring drive before the end of the half as Alabama was able to push it down the field in a hurry. And the number one team in the country, not facing the same hangover teams like Ohio State and Florida had in their first halves today.
Trying to figure out where to get your Christmas gifts, and I have the answer for you right here at Academy Sports and Outdoors. They have everything that you might need, including trampolines. Let's just not wait to wrap up the trampoline, put it under the tree. Just go ahead and get it right now so you can have fun all season long, right?
What a performance by Mac Jones. He's thrown for two touchdowns on 13 completions. Najee Harris has a pair of rushing touchdowns. While other great teams struggled in their afternoon time slots, no struggles for Alabama. Zach Johnson takes a fair catch. Ohio State got all they could handle from Indiana earlier today.
Yeah, they did.
And Vanderbilt had a first half lead on Florida before the Gators put it together in the second half.
There was drama everywhere. Kyle Trask and Florida ended up pulling out, but just how quickly things can change. Beginning of the second quarter, Kentucky's inside the red zone on the third down. Don't get it. Field goal is
Barry Wilson, 10 of 16
touchdown
in this game.
And a couple other touchdowns to follow, and now Kentucky's got to dig themselves out of a big hole.
Here's Kavassier Smoke. Able to pick up a couple. Jordan, why do you think Kentucky went away from the shifts and the motions that they did on their first few possessions?
That's what's difficult about being an offensive coordinator. You're always looking for what's next and what can beat somebody. And that's the thing. Eddie Grant even said, you know, before the time off, he said, I was being a knucklehead. I was trying to reach for stuff. I was looking for opportunities, and I was getting away from what we did best. And I think he got away a little bit from what they did so well in the first quarter. And as offensive coordinator, you just got to check yourself every now and then. I think he'll go into halftime. He'll go, hey, we're going to get back
choosing not to take their
what we
for
did.
10 seconds of traction because
but now
it's helmet came off.
A little too late.
Therefore, by rule, the clock will start when the ball is legally snapped.
So 38 seconds left in a second and 7. Eddie Grand missed some time due to COVID precautions in the middle of the season for this Kentucky team. Darren Hinshaw, the quarterback coach, was the play caller. And they're without Darren Hinshaw today. And Hinshaw is the guy that was kind of the guy who keeps Eddie Grand in check when it comes to taking those shots each quarter. And a helpful reminder, another set of eyes and ears from an offensive standpoint. Kavassier Smoke with the carry. That looked like Kentucky's going to bother with another play this quarter. Mark Stoops' team got off to a good start in this one. Trailed 7-3 with a goal line shot. Ran a quarterback run that got him nothing. And then the special teams disasters followed. And since then, all Alabama. 28-3 is our score at the break. Plenty to talk about it. A busy day in the SEC. Bama will receive the second half kickoff. And they'll have a chance to continue what has been an all-Alabama afternoon. Let's get you back to the studio. Here's Dari and the gang. SEC Network Football presented by Farm Ridge. Bryant-Denny Stadium, a beautiful late afternoon in Tuscaloosa, getting ready to start the second half. First half, all Alabama.
Really been the story of the season. Yeah, it's been the story of the season for Mac Jones, how lethal he's been downfield, and really the Achilles heel for Kentucky, the inability to complement their run game with anything downfield, and that's been the glaring issue for Terry Wilson. It continues tonight.
Cole, what'd you learn from Mark Stoops?
Well, I talked to him after he came out from halftime, asked him about the offense. He said, we feel pretty good about the way we're moving the football, just need to be better in the red zone. No difference in quarterback philosophy in the second half. Also asked him about the defense and special teams. He said, we're not going to change anything with our field goal procedure through at least the third quarter. Going to stick with it and obviously try to get points if we're in position.
Ryan Robinson will bring this one out of the end zone, and he takes it to the 25-yard line. Just a couple of big plays really have turned this into a 25-point Alabama advantage, which is at one point a 7-3 contest.
Yeah, and it should have been, could have been 7-6 right here, and a hot snap over the head of the holder turns into a big loss for Kentucky, which turns into a huge play for Alabama. You can't give the number one team in the country opportunities, and again, a wobbly snap makes it tough on the holder. Another missed opportunity to get points, and that has been the story, and Alabama has had an answer through the air and towards the end of that first half on the ground with Najee Harris.
Mac Jones, 200 yards through the air in the first half. Najee Harris, two touchdowns. He gets hit in the backfield by Boogie Watson on the first play, and they take him down for a loss of 6.
Look, I know it sounds crazy, but if I've been in the locker room in these type of games for Kentucky, right? I've been down a lot. But if you're Kentucky in that locker room, the message was we're hurting ourselves. We're moving the football. We're hurting ourselves in the red zone with penalties, bad operation, and special teams. So you're not completely defeated if you're Kentucky, but it's a really important drive to start the game to get the ball back in the offense's hands and try to close the gap.
Nick Saban, talking to Cole Half, was not happy with his team's play in the first half. Harris makes the first man miss, turns it into a gain of 8, and gets it all back. Quandre Mosley with the stop for Kentucky in the secondary.
We talked about the vision of Najee Harris. I think it's so improved, and I got a chance to talk to Charles Huff, their running back coach, and he said, look, every time Najee touched the football early in his career, he was trying to hit a home run. I had to explain to him, in order to be a big league home run hitter, you got to first learn to hit for average in the minor leagues. He said Najee looked at him like, what are you talking about?
We don't ride buses in pro football. Mac Jones to the out route. Open again. And a first down for Alabama to Devontae Smith. Pickup of 18.
But to that point, Tom, you know, in the minor leagues as a hitter, you learn what fastballs look like. You learn how to read a curveball. At a running back at an early age, you got to learn what fronts look like, what linebacker rotation and movement looks like, and then be able to walk through it. And that's what Charles Huff did with Najee Harris. They jogged through it. They walked through it. They watched film and got him to a place where his tempo and his patience are now elite to complement his physical skill set.
On play action, Jones deep shot. It is incomplete, but a flag on the play on Yusuf Corker trying to get to Smith again.
And again, when the run game is going, there's nothing more dangerous than the play action. And when you got Devontae Smith out there, just look at how smooth he runs this route.
Defense number 29, 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic.
I thought Greg McElroy earlier today on SEC Nation made a great point. He said Devontae reminds him of Marvin Harrison. And I thought from a physical standpoint, that was a great comparison, but more so from a savviness standpoint. Like, he navigates routes and he finds space and he does it so fluidly. He never looks like he's running. And that's tough for a defender when a guy doesn't look like he's in his fifth gear, but really he's in his fifth gear. And that's why you've got to sometimes get a flag to prevent a big play.
Came into today with only one drop on 72 targets in the course of the season. Play action again. Jones going deep again. Right back to him, and it's intercepted by Kelvin Joseph. You know the vibe. He takes it past the 20, and Joseph takes it down. That's his fourth interception of the season, 12th for the Kentucky Wildcats.
And that's really the first misstep on a deep ball I've seen out of Mac Jones. And this is great positioning by Kelvin Joseph. You talk about being in phase. In phase, hip to hip, then you find the ball, you lean and locate. That's a great job of leaning, right? Walling off Devontae Smith, locating the football, and being right in position. That is textbook for a corner. And Kelvin Joseph comes up with a huge play when Kentucky needed it. Man, it's a big play.
He mentioned to us that they've gone one-on-one number of times throughout their high school career, both in 7-7 and over the course of the summers. A.J. Rose in the backfield. Rose to the left side has a monster hole on the edge, and he picks up 19 yards. Rare interception for Mac Jones, just his third of the season.
And he looks frustrated with himself. He should be. I think he was just a little late on that throw. I think he would like to release that a little sooner, and then you can't leave it inside. As a quarterback, the sideline is your best friend. You got to miss there if possible. But he'll rebound.
Big shot for Kelvin Joseph, who's got a Tyler Hero jersey hanging on his wall back in Lexington. Wilson, incomplete.
Boss man Fats got to track no handouts. He proved it there as he took that one away.
Did you go back through the entire Boss Man Fat catalog, Cole?
All seven songs? Yeah.
You asked him on our call the other day, hey, what if Tom Jordan and I wanted to put out some tracks? Like, how easy would that be?
I haven't gotten that look from a player in my entire career.
He shut it down. He looked at us like, no, just don't even.
Wilson keeps it and picks up three.
My point in that conversation, Tom, was if you're a college football player, the first thing you don't have much of is time. And if you just wanted to try to get a song on, say, iTunes, what would that process even look like? How would we even begin that? Finding a producer, finding a beat, getting your lyrics, putting them down, finding somebody to download it, go and do the edits, all the different things that you need. What would that process even look like? I can't fathom being able to do that with everything you're juggling as a college football player.
He thought he would be immediately eligible at Kentucky. That didn't work out for him. Had to sit out a year. Crossing route to Ali with five wide, and that's too strong and incomplete.
This is one of the sets I was speaking about early. When they go empty here, it's a great opportunity to attack the middle void. A quarterback draw here when they go empty. I've mentioned it a couple times already. Look at the void there over the center. There's nobody there. You turn those defensive linemen out, and you got an opportunity for a big play there. So I thought it was interesting. Grant got away from a lot of the movement. I thought that's something he'd get back to like they did in the first quarter. Not a ton of movement pre-snap there for Kentucky, and they're punting away.
Alan Goodfellow with the punt. Nick Saban even mentioned that. That movement was giving us issues in the first quarter, but they did go away from it. 55-yard punt, back in a moment. Alabama's offense back on the field after the Mac Jones interception. We talked with Nick Saban about how Mac is tough on himself. You know, he comes from an athletic family. His dad played tennis at Florida State, then went on to a professional tennis career. His mom was also a college tennis player. And as we take another look at this pick from Jones, it's interesting that Nick Saban has laid a nickname on Mac Jones that has a tennis background when he gets frustrated and starts talking to himself, Cole.
Yeah, going back to his time on the scout team when he would play against the third teamers, he would come over sometimes against the first teamers, he would get visibly upset with himself and said he would talk to himself and yell at himself. So Nick Saban would refer to him as John McEnroe. And he would tell Mac Jones, quit being John McEnroe. Don't act like John McEnroe. You sound like John McEnroe yelling at yourself. He's kind of kicking the grass, throwing a fit. So John McEnroe, early in his Alabama career, was Mac Jones' nickname from Nick Saban.
Good thing there aren't umpires in chairs here, over the middle and incomplete. And it goes in line with what Jeremy Pruitt told us about Mac Jones first running the scout team offense back when Pruitt, now the Tennessee head coach, was the defensive coordinator at Bama. Jordan, he said that the Mac Jones you see now is nothing like the Mac Jones that was running the scout team.
No, your eyes get wider going against the number one defense. You're forgetting snaps. You're forgetting motions. That's what Pruitt said. He said he couldn't even get the guys lined up. And so it's amazing to look at his progression and development over the years, you know, as a quarterback with the X's and O's, but also what Cole was talking about there. There's nothing that's more important, I think, than to Nick Saban than body language and leadership, right? And when you're frustrated with yourself, when you're fidgeting, that affects the other 10 guys and the entire team around you. And that's one of the reasons he kind of made fun of him for it, but also pushed him to eliminate that negative body language as much as possible.
Saban shared a story with us yesterday about A.J. McCarron, whose freshman year was running with the third team in a scrimmage and had to deal with the drops and bad plays by his teammates. He marched into Saban's office afterwards and he said, why do you have me running with third team? And Nick told him, you know what, the only thing you're being judged on today was your leadership and the way you pouted and got on your teammates made you a bad teammate and disliked by them through this one scrimmage. You failed the one test. McCarron got it right. He ended up being the backup later that season, and well, he ended up with a just fine Alabama career.
How cool is that? I mean, just the wherewithal, and I mean the depth of coaching knowledge and the depth to which Nick Saban will test his players, right? He knew McCarron should have been competing for the starting job, but he wanted to see how he responded as a leader. He didn't care about the throws. That's one of the reasons he continues to develop guys.
Intercepted by Alabama, and this one's going the other way. A pick six for Jordan Battle and a 44-yard return.
Well, what did I say about Jordan Battle earlier in the game? He's a film junkie, right? Set it on a play where Terry Wilson threw a slant. What'd they do here? They lined up and ran slants. I mean, there's no motion. There's no shifting. They just lined up, ran a slant. And when you got Jordan Battle sitting out there recognizing it again, he goes, oh, I saw this last time. Last time I knocked it down at the line of scrimmage. This time, I'm taking it to the house.
Officially 45 yards on the pick six. He met you on our Zoom call this week, and he said, hey, nice name. I think maybe he has a better smile than you do.
Oh,
these guys having a blast. Terry Wilson throws it to the wrong team, and Alabama's rolling now. We'll see if that leads to a quarterback shift for the Wildcats next time out. Postseason dates, get to that in a moment. Best chance to reach the playoff, according to our All-State playoff predictor, Alabama checking in 89%. BYU is blowing away teams from North Alabama right now. They got a 25% chance. Cincinnati with a key win today.
A&M. A&M's Alabama
right there.
Runs the table. They got a good shot. If Alabama runs the table, they'll be sitting at 9-1. I mean, okay, presuming they win out, which is a good opportunity they do. It'll be tough, but it could be a 9-1 team there sitting on the outside with an opportunity.
Joey Gatewood's going to take over quarterback for Kentucky, the Auburn transfer. Played a little bit against Vandy, did not attempt a pass, but got the start against Georgia. Completed 15 passes, but only 91 yards. What's the purpose of going to Joey Gatewood at this moment?
I think you need to see what you got in him. You know he's a physical, dynamic runner at times, but you haven't really seen him throw the football effectively, and you haven't really tried. Remember the Georgia game? We were just like, are they going to throw it downfield at some point? They really didn't, and you know, I don't know if they know what they have in him yet as a passer. They know what they have in him athletically. Let's see if they roll it out. Might as well. 35-3. See what he's got.
Got Kabashe Smoke with him in the backfield. And they will hand it off to Smoke, who finds it going tough, just 1 yard over the right side, and thrown to the ground by Christian Barmore.
Boy, Boy, Barmore's made a couple big boy plays tonight. He's tossed a couple Kentucky O-linemen out of the way. That's what they need. They need somebody up front to emerge. They always have a guy up there, right? Like a Raekwon or, you know, Williams down there. I mean, but they haven't had it this year, and they need that down the stretch.
91st in the country against the pass is Alabama. On second and eight, Gatewood to throw against the three-man rush. Incomplete off of Ali's hands. And he got laid out by Christian Harris.
Wow, that was a big hit.
Ali's coming off the field.
And that read shouldn't have taken Joey Gatewood here. You got a guy driving on that route from out in front. You got to move on. That's one thing Eddie Graham mentioned about Joey Gatewood. They need him to anticipate a little bit better, get the ball out faster. And he was a little late and on the wrong read on that one.
Gatewood was a four-star recruit coming out of Bartram Trail High School in Jacksonville. For three dual-threat quarterback in the country. Looks like the play clock ran out.
Play of game, offense, 5-yard penalty. It remains third down.
Mark Stoops is looking for some explosiveness in his offense, and they had it in the first quarter. They had some big plays, but nothing since, and Gatewood can't get the snap off here.
That's one of the things that it may seem easy, but it's just when you're out on the field and it's not practice, your eyes are everywhere, your mind is everywhere, but that big clock right in front of you down by the goalpost, and that's really where it needs to be. You need to have an understanding of that clock. But you mentioned it, the explosive plays. Haven't really seen it, and they haven't done the motions, haven't done the shifts. There's one motion here, but first quarter we saw 2-3 guys at once.
Third and 13, incomplete again. Trying to fit it into the freshman, Michael Drennan. DeMarco Helms out of DeMatha basketball school in the D.C. area comes up with a big football play.
That's not a tough game to pick up inside. If Alabama walks up a linebacker in one of the A-gaps, you can almost rest assured it's a three-man game inside. I'd say 85-90% of the time, that's what you're going to get. That's what you got right there. The middle three don't switch it off, thus quarterback takes a hit.
Devontae Smith now in a punt return. Slate Bolton looked like he was injured on the previous punt. He's been in the medical tent. Smith from the 30. Smith trying to get the edge. Clean block there to the 40, to the 50, to the other 40, and he's taken down in Kentucky territory after a sensational return of 42 yards.
And this one is going to be on the referee teach tape, right? I mean, they're trying to get rid of these blindside blocks. And look at, is it Patrick Surtain or is there number two? But look at him put his arms up, just shield the defender there. It opens up the hole in the lane for Devontae Smith.
Jalen Waddle injured at first kickoff of the Tennessee game. Put Slate Bolden back there. Now it's Devontae Smith. Waddle got his cast off this week. There's talk that he might be able to get back before the season is over. Brian Robinson, the Tuscaloosa native with a carry. Pickup of 7. So there's a lot still to come for this Alabama team, both as a team and when it comes to individual honors. And Mac Jones certainly part of the Heisman conversation. Injured player is Brandon Echols for Kentucky. So if you look at the numbers that some very talented quarterbacks have put up, let's treat this, as they call in the business, as a blind reveal. Who do you like, Jordan?
Tell you what, I like those two guys on the right side, just looking at the blind reveal, right? Almost 80%. Guy on the left, a bunch of touchdown passes. I mean, I think I know who they are.
This is like going to a Braves game and playing the hat game. Like, where is the marble? Under which hat? Joe Burrow from last year had possibly the best season we've ever seen in college football, and Mac Jones has put up similar numbers.
You know what's impressive about Mac and Kyle? All SEC games. Those numbers you see from Burrow, Four of those six games for Burrow, three were non-conference, Georgia Southern, Northwestern State, Utah State. The other was Vandy. 18 of his touchdowns came against those four teams. And Trask and Jones have done it against all SEC opponents. I mean, there is an asterisk by this year. And for the guys that are playing well, it's a good asterisk.
To be fair, Burrow continued on that same pace second half of the season. But let's talk about Mac Jones a little bit.
Well, I mean, there's just so many things he does so well. And it's great because he doesn't have a huge arm. He's not a dual threat guy, but he's so accurate. Tonight, he's by times when he needed to. He was accurate downfield. The one interception downfield is really the only time I've seen a bad ball, I think, going back over film. For those deep throws, he's been so accurate on those, and that's what the next level loves. The NFL loves his deep ball accuracy, and again, it's not because he can throw it 80 yards, but it's the trajectory and the accuracy, right? It's how he gets it up and down and puts it right where he needs to.
He has set a school record with four passes of 85 yards or more in his career, out in front and incomplete. Meanwhile, let's look at Trask's numbers. It was a slow start for Florida on the road at Vandy.
Yeah, what a ho-hum day, right? Right? 380 yards almost, three touchdowns. Man, he looked terrible. But they did get a slow start. Vandy had a good plan early. Vandy's offense got out to a quick start. But at the end of the day, just too many weapons for Kyle Trask. And let me tell you, that's a bad game for him, which is crazy to say. But this season, that's a bad game for him.
Vandy lost by three touchdowns today. I just want to take a moment and bring to everyone's attention what a job Derek Mason's doing at Vanderbilt this year. They were hit hard with opt-outs before the season even started. They've had to deal with COVID maybe more so than others. Yet, while some teams have decided, you know what, we probably don't have enough to play here or there, Vandy has taken the field regularly, and they gave Florida all they could handle the first half.
With a true freshman quarterback. Right? Yeah. I mean, it's very commendable what Derek Mason's been able to do there, and it's already hard enough at Vandy. I know that better than anybody. So they gave Florida everything they could today. Credit to them.
Speaking of COVID, Mississippi State has been hit hard. They're at Georgia later tonight. They have 49 scholarship players. They only have one scholarship quarterback available. Jones, end zone, incomplete. Will Rogers will get the start for Mississippi State. His backup not only hasn't played this season, but is a walk-on. And a hungry Georgia team. Nice. Alabama perfect in the red zone tonight, Cole.
Yeah, nice blitz pick up there by Landon Dickerson, Alabama center. Good job patiently waiting that route to open up. That ball actually standing right here in the back of the end zone. Went off the face mask of Smith. Not sure if the contact was a little bit early or not, but looks catchable to me.
Figured Landon Dickerson would be moving people out of the way. Have you seen the bumper on his truck? Second and 10, Robinson. Straight ahead. And Robinson takes it to the 5 and a first down, a pickup of 12.
And right up the middle again, right behind Landon Dickerson in that interior offensive line. Look at the push. Look at Dickerson climb to the next level. He picked up two guys on that play and opened up a big hole for Brian Robinson.
He had truck issues. A tow truck came and got it one day, and they ripped his bumper off. So what did he do? He put a railroad tie on the front of his truck. Is that street legal?
I talked to him earlier this week. I said, dude, is that a tree on the front of your pickup you got there? He said, that's his hobby, though. 2013 F-250. Loves working on that truck.
Mac Jones rolls, and he's able to find Devontae Smith, and Smith taken down at the 1.
You know, last thing on that truck, I spoke to former Tennessee coach Butch Jones on the field actually before the game, and we were talking about Landon Dickerson and what a good pro he's going to make in his prospects, and he asked me, he said, have you seen the truck? I said, actually, I have. Yeah, I saw a picture of it, talked to him about it. He said, first thing he did, he came to the facility that day, he said, coach, have you seen my bumper? You got to see the bumper. Come out here. Look at the license plate. Got the license plate right on there, too. I was able to get it in. Proud of that railroad tie bumper.
Most people screw in the license plates. He puts his in with drill bits.
They're going to go right behind him here. Watch this.
Three tight ends in the game. Good push by Kentucky. Doesn't matter. Brian Robinson Jr. is in with a one-yard touchdown plunge.
That time, Dickerson got in a little bit of a fender bender to start that play. And then he was able to rebound. Kentucky did a good job of driving out. Watch him up front here. He gets pushed back a little bit, but recovers and is able to help push. Not that he maybe needed to, but.
Extra point is good after a 7-play, 29-yard drive. And Nick Saban's team has extended its advantage. Tied in control late in the third quarter. From the City of Roses, Bryce Young getting loose on the Alabama sideline behind Mac Jones. Alabama 42-3. Mac Jones 16 of 24, two touchdowns and a pick.
A lot of people
Kentucky's played two quarterbacks. Go ahead.
A lot of people that thought Bryce Young might take over at some point this year before, obviously, the season started, and Mac has played out of his mind, so no need to take that, but it'd be good to see the young kid toss it around.
Speaking of new quarterbacks, might see a new one for Georgia tonight. JT Daniels expected to get the start as Georgia matches up with Mississippi State right here on the SEC Network at 7:30. Same time over on the alternate channel, Eli Drinkwitz, Missouri Tigers take on South Carolina as a return to action without Will Muschamp. Mississippi State averaging its fewest points and yards per game since 2008 under the Pirate.
Jeez, right before Dan Mullen took over.
They will be shorthanded tonight. Gatewood hands it off to A.J. Rose. Gain of five. Kentucky came into this game heavy underdogs by 30 points plus. So I did a little bit of research. The largest spread for an AP number one ranked team that lost was 27. That was Ohio State in 1998. The opponent was Michigan State. The opposing coach was Nick Saban. No such luck for the underdogs tonight. Gatewood almost picked up. Battle almost got his second. How much of this is reaction? How much is film work?
Oh, it's everything. I mean, you got to have the film work to allow your athleticism to take over. If you have good instincts, it starts with the film work. Just watch the instincts of Battle as he breaks on these balls. I mean, he's playing that inside out. He's essentially running the route. He knows where the ball's going, and that's one of the things with Gatewood. It looks right now that he's looking at one option. Right, he knows the play and knows where he wants to go, and he's just not moving on because last couple throws, it hasn't been there.
Play clock winding down, 4 seconds left. They've already run out of time once with Gatewood at quarterback. Pressure on him, dumps it over the middle again, and a big knock. It's Helms, a sophomore from DeMatho, with the hit on an incompletion.
And that time, actually, Joey Gatewood does work to the running back on his left first. You're going to see his eyes work outside left, and he comes back to this little rub route underneath. But, man, when you don't have the threat of throwing the football over the top, as Kentucky has zero threat of that right now, everything starts to condense. And Alabama is playing really well underneath right now. Just reading eyes.
Goodfellow, the senior out of St. Ignatius in Cleveland, to punt it away again. Vontae Smith back. Fair catch asked for and taken at the 23. Let's get to the studio. Here's Dari.
Tom, just to let everybody know what's coming up over on ESPN at 7 o'clock Eastern time. Tank Bigsby and Auburn running the ball like they want to do. Taking on Tennessee. 49 days. Tom and gang, 49 days since Tennessee last won a football game. Vols and War Eagle coming up on ESPN 70.
A much different second half of the season this year than last for Tennessee. Bryce Young is in at quarterback. Alabama's got a run of now 20 consecutive games with at least 35 points. You have to go back to the national championship game in 2019. Last time that didn't happen. That was calendar year 19. Over the top, down the sideline, caught. Devontae Smith. Hello, Bryce Young.
I mean, you think Steve Sarkisian has any faith in this kid. Cold off the bench. He's thrown a couple balls on the sidelines. So, yeah, let's just throw this one deep down. Look at the accuracy.
30,
jeez.
The 15-yard penalty will be added at the end of the run.
That is automatic a perfect down. Ball on Brandon Echols, who is Kentucky's best one-on-one cover guy. And that's best on best right there. And this, you can't get any better than that throw right there. Ooh, a little extra.
Yeah, that drew a flag from J.J. Weaver. It'll add some yardage on to the end of the play. Longest completion in the early career for Bryce Young for 36 yards. Najee Harris has room, and he spins inside the 20, still on his feet behind the umpire. Umpire lost his hat and went down. Najee Harris with the first down run.
Boy, stripes with the mustache. He's going to be feeling that tomorrow. How about Najee? Look at the vision. This is what I was talking about earlier. The vision, obviously knowing that you're 235. I mean, just, I know I was lost by watching the ref. You see that?
You got a mark on the forehead.
But where do you go? You know, you can't hide.
How about Echols yanking him right back into the pile?
I'd have to put a bag of frozen peas on the forehead when he goes to bed tonight. Walt looks like he's given and taken some in his life. He's well built.
See, they're really not talking about anything except they're laughing at him right now. They all got those microphones to go, man, like, hey, get out of the way.
Let's all talk about what just happened to Walt. Can't wait to see him at the 6 a.m. flight out of Birmingham tomorrow.
Oh, that's amazing. Well, a forearm shiver. Oh, yeah, then his legs get taken out. That doesn't feel good.
Well, that gator up a little bit higher, maybe.
he's running high back, right now.
Back to the ground game, and Najee Harris picks up 8. We talked with Nick Saban yesterday and brought up the fact that there's been discussion that there may be movement in the playoff calendar, whether that be in regard to the SEC championship game moving back after Christmas, the playoffs, and the national championship. He said, listen, these players have been practicing like this is the 11th week of the season. We can't extend it any further. They don't deserve that. We've got to think about the players more. Now, there's a lot of different people involved in those discussions, but make no mistake about it, Nick Saban will insist that his voice is heard. Robinson cuts back, takes it to the 5. I mean, he was pretty animated by the end of that conversation on the Zoom call, Jordan.
Yeah, he was. And you think about it, especially in this COVID era, you can do everything right, but if the opposing team isn't taking it as seriously as you are, well, then you're punished, right? I mean, like the LSU game, that gets rescheduled. Well, Alabama did everything right, and yet they're punished with having to reschedule that game. You know, it's, and again, like you mentioned, these players have been practicing. Yes, the season started later than normal, but they were scrimmaging, they were practicing, they were hitting. So, yeah, their bodies, they take a toll. Just because there's not a game doesn't mean their bodies aren't taking a toll. So it's already going to be a long season. Extending it further, you would seriously have to think about what that does for player safety.
A lot of stakeholders in this game, and some of them would love to see it extended. Make sure the games can be played. Florida State Clemson canceled last minute this morning, or at least postponed. Young taken down in the backfield, and Kentucky gets a sack from Boogie Watson. It's a loss of 7.
That's just knowing down in the red zone where your stress areas are. As a young quarterback, protections are usually the thing that come later on in your development, understanding where your stress points are. Right? Just because you may be protected to one side, you may not be as strong to that side. And that time, the slide went away from the left, and Young wasn't able to get the ball out in time. Took a sack there. It's all great learning opportunities, though, for a young quarterback.
false start. Offense, number 65, 5-yard penalty. It remains third down.
So here's the beauty of Ken Williamson being the referee. Not only does he get the FaceTime and get to speak, but he also stays out of harm's way. Right? A referee never gets caught in the traffic like his buddy Walt did a few plays ago.
Oh, but he gets the mouthful from the quarterback all game. I used to give the white hat so much. I'm like, come on, they're hitting me late. Like, what are you doing? You get a lot of talk back from the quarterbacks usually.
Third and goal. Bryce Young eludes one, throws on the line. Touchdown, a spin in for Devontae Smith.
This is the new era of offense and the new prototypical attribute for quarterbacks in this day and age, the ability to get outside the pocket and throw off platform. Look what Young does here. It's a great move to get outside the pocket, and then watch the arm angle moving away. He fits that ball into a window that is not even there. Wow. Look at that accuracy. Wow.
Number one dual threat quarterback coming out of modern day in California. One after is good. A 7-play, 76-yard scoring drive led by Bryce Young. And Devontae Smith on the other end, the SEC all-time leader now in receiving touchdowns. Weapon after weapon after weapon.
Yeah, you have a Heisman Trophy possible quarterback dropping dimes all over the field. And then you have a guy that if you handed the ball him 30 times a game, he'd win the Heisman Trophy as well. It's an embarrassment of riches. You got one of the best receivers, the best receiver statistically in Alabama history. He will be when this is said and done. And now you got a young quarterback coming off the bench making plays as well. It's unbelievable.
Mari Cooper will be in action tomorrow. Cowboys in the afternoon time slot. Wonder what Chris Doering's going to be doing tomorrow. .42 to go in the third quarter. Bama by 46. So Cooper's got the Vikings tomorrow. Chris Doering has the couch. For more, here are the folks back in the studio.
What am I going to be doing tomorrow? It's my, like, lone day off. I appreciate Devontae for bringing my name back up, though. I don't think anybody actually knew that I had the touchdown record up until the last couple of weeks. So appreciate him for making me famous again, man.
Seriously, as we've watched this happen, you knew it was going to happen sooner rather than later. How have you kind of dealt with the reality? Because you had this thing for 25 years, at least a split of it.
In the old days when I was less mature, I had that voodoo doll that I'd kind of wish bad things. Really bad things. But just, things to slow them down.
Yeah.
Go to the NFL early. But it's been good to watch Devontae have so much success.
Guys, kick it back to you.
New quarterback in for Kentucky is Bo Allen, the freshman out of Lexington Catholic. Maybe the quarterback of the future for this Kentucky team. Jordan, I'm a little bit surprised we didn't see Bo Allen earlier, but he's got great promise as a fantastic thrower.
Yeah, it's been the Achilles heel for Kentucky, the inability to complement the run game. And I think Bo is the most natural thrower of the three quarterbacks. And
he loses the football on the way down, but able to find it as Christian Harris got pressure on him.
Yeah, they wanted to get him in earlier last week. Got him in the fourth quarter when they were up 17. It ended up being a game towards the end against Vanderbilt. But he sees the field really well. He maybe doesn't have the arm talent, the arm strength that Terry Wilson has, but he's got accuracy, he's got moxie, and he just needs opportunity. And although it's 49-3, that doesn't matter. This is great developmental opportunity for Bo Allen and his coaching staff to see what they have in him.
On the Paul Horning Award is the top player in the state of Kentucky, coming out of Lexington Catholic on 3rd and 16 now. Surveys. Tries to scramble and gets taken down by Christopher Allen. And that'll bring up fourth down and an end of the third quarter. Alabama has played three different quarterbacks. Wilson, Gatewood, and now, pardon me, Kentucky has played three different. Wilson, Allen, and Gatewood, and none of them have been able to solve this Alabama defense. Pick six for Battle. A touchdown run for the senior Robinson, and Alabama continues to roll.
.3 Alabama as the Crimson Tide will be in punt return formation. Wide receiver Devonta Smith will be back deep. Slade Bolden limped off the field a little bit later. Looked like he had his right ankle retaped, went into the injury tent, spent a lot of time there, and has not returned to this football game since, fellas.
Number 85 for Alabama is now wearing number 60. 85 is wearing 60.
So that's obviously key with Alabama's depth. The thought that Waddle may be returning late in this season. Kendall Randolph is now in the game wearing number 60 for Alabama. Tight end slash offensive lineman. You heard that announced. Here's Devonta Smith from the 36. 48-yard punt and 8 on the return. Another look at Bryce Young, the fantastic freshman, calling the plays for Bama after this.
Which, as we know, is Championship Saturday. I know there's another team that's currently undefeated that plays NC State that they could schedule a game with on that day if they wanted to. It's Hugh Freeze's Liberty Flames. But I do believe that they have some flexibility. And now with the Pac-12 also being able to schedule some non-conference games, if I'm UAB, I'm scooping up as many big-name opponents as possible, because the one thing that's going to keep them out of consideration is their resume when you're talking about the college football playoffs.
Right. You meant BYU, obviously. Third and two now for Alabama and Bryce Young. I don't know if you're the Pac-12. I don't know if you schedule BYU. I mean, I know you want to get games, and that's why you've opened up the window to play non-conference. I think you just politely decline when the Cougars place a phone call, because if they get in, they're taking a spot that otherwise you would be competing for.
All right, let me turn that around for you, though, Tom. If you're the Pac-12, let's say you're Mario Cristobal, you're Kyle Whittingham, and you go undefeated, are you going to have a resume good enough to realistically be considered for the college football playoff? I think the Pac-12 needs a BYU on their schedule to realistically be considered to get in.
That's a fair point. I don't know anybody would have thought that would have been said any year besides 1984. Here's Jace McClellan with the big gain and a first down run, taking Bossman Fat with him. It's a pickup of 18. When it comes to the SEC, conference obviously in good position to get a team in at 97%, and the second behind the Big Ten odds of getting a second team in. BYU currently 25% chance to reach the playoff after their blowout win today. That was actually coming into this weekend.
I mean, doesn't all this talk just play into the fact that they should have just for 1 year said, let's go 8?
Thank you.
Right. I mean, you have the built-in excuse of COVID and not be able to evaluate teams with non-conferences and not everybody playing the same amount of games. Like, let's just play 8. Let's see how it goes. And you don't have to say we're doing this forever. We're doing it one time, and then we're going back. I think that was a huge miss. I would have loved to see it as a college football fan. I'd love to see BYU or Cincinnati have a chance, but I don't think they have a chance when there's a one-loss, or if there's a one-loss SEC team out there, or even a one-loss Big Ten or ACC.
If it were today, speaking of one-loss teams, you'd take an A&M or Florida.
Oh, if we're picking today, I'm taking Florida. And again, that's the quandary that the committee's in, right? Because A&M beat them heads up. But I think there has to be an understanding of recency. And there has to be an understanding that teams can develop and get better. And it was almost 6 weeks ago that A&M beat Florida. And I think they're a different team right now, and they're hot right now. So that's what it comes down to, and that's why you wish that there was a few more opportunities to see some of those teams have a chance.
Jimbo Fisher's team sitting at home today instead of hosting Ole Miss. Lane's clipboard gets a day off. Roydell Williams, freshman from Hueytown High School, makes it straight ahead. Starters getting a breather here through the fourth quarter for a team that hadn't played in 3 weeks. Mac Jones still with the helmet on, like he wants to get back in this game. Right, wears his helmet to bed. Here's Roydell Williams on the left side, and it crawls down to the fourth.
I don't think he misses arm day in the gym. You know, I miss it quite often. Roydell does not miss arm day, Tom. Do you remember what arm day was like, Tom?
No. I missed all days. They did not count me as present. Williams again. This win, by the way, with 10 minutes still to play in this one, I feel confident, will be Alabama's 30th consecutive win against the SEC East. It will be Nick Saban's 96th straight win against an unranked opponent. That's the longest stretch in FBS history.
That's just ridiculous. I mean, everybody talks about the process. Everybody wonders why Saban assistants are held in such high regard. It's because of that, the consistency, the ability to ward off complacency, all the things that go into making a winning team that don't necessarily involve the X's and O's. He does unbelievably well.
Williams is in for his first career touchdown from 2 yards out. Najee Harris excited for the next great Alabama running back.
Yeah, being the biggest cheerleader on the sideline, you'd love to see that.
Rikers extra point is good. 5.5 off the clock, a 10-play, 56-yard drive. And Roydell Williams punches it in for Nick Saban's team.
SEC Network Football is presented by Farm Ridge. Grab a snack.
No action for Clemson today. Ohio State got pushed to the brink by Indiana. Notre Dame the weekend off, and Alabama will soon be 7-0. Been about 80 years since they started 6-0, didn't win their seventh. Yes, offensive lineman dancing, I'm here for all of it. Landon Dickerson says, this is how we do it in Hickory, folks.
At the road tie, the railroad tie bumpers and dancing like that. Nice.
Chase Allen will kick off now for Bama. Up by 53, fair catch taken. All right, those are the top six. That was in reverse order, guys. Let's talk about yours. Aiming for the playoff predictor. Jordan's old haircut still looks good. I mean, there's no difference. Come on.
What do you just for my old haircut or?
No, see, and this is also yours. This is the recency bias, right? And this is why I had Florida ahead of Texas A&M, because I think right now they're a better team. But again, you can't fault Cole because Texas A&M has the head-to-head.
Guys have Ohio State, Notre Dame flip. Jordan, why you got Ohio State at 3?
Just because I haven't seen enough out of them yet up until today, and we did that before what we saw. Even still, I just haven't seen enough, a big enough body of work. But look, the rankings right now, and the rankings that we see on Tuesday, it's going to be a most deserving, right? They'll probably have Texas A&M ahead of Florida. They'll probably have Notre Dame ahead of Clemson because those teams deserve to be. But at some point down the road in the final selection, it's about the four best. You throw out the head-to-head if it happened 2 months ago, and you look at what teams have done over the last month and what their entire body of work is. So you end up finding the best four, even though for a while I think it looks more like who's most deserving of the ranking.
Why do you even play the first quarter of the season if we're going to throw it out? What's the point of even having it if we're just going to judge teams by the last 3 or 4 weeks?
Well, no, I mean,
Byron,
if you have
Young on the stop.
To that logic, Cole, if Florida goes and beats Alabama, then they're a one-loss team, so is Texas A&M. And Texas A&M beat Florida, and Florida beat Bama, so what do you do there? Yeah, you look at the entire body of work, but right now Florida would have been a better team. I'm not saying that's going to happen. We're saying I think you got to look at how teams develop. And yes, you can't discount head-to-head, but teams do have a chance to develop from week three to whatever it is, week 10.
Yeah, that's true.
Third and 11 for the freshman quarterback over the middle and off the mark, and Kentucky will punt it away again. In the second half, Kentucky quarterbacks have combined to go 0-for-9 with an interception.
And look, Alabama is a tough defense to go against, especially when you're one-dimensional. When you're in this big of a hole and Alabama can play their match zone underneath, there's just the windows are so small. And Kentucky already isn't the strongest at the quarterback position or the most accurate. They want to develop in that area. It's just that's why Alabama's so good. You got to keep the game close. You got to make them play it your way. And when you don't, it's hard to be successful.
Goodfellow punts it away. Surtain takes a fair catch. 49-yard punt, 8:19 remaining. We'll see what Alabama's offense looks like next. Mack still got his helmet on. I might take off early and hit the drive-thru if you guys are good with that.
Oh, I'm texting my fiance right now. She's in a drive-thru. I'm telling her to get me something. I'm starving.
Chili cheese burrito to go. Back to action, and Alabama runs it with Jace McClellan. Bryce Young, a quarterback for Alabama. Interesting conversation with Saban yesterday, and we're talking about coaching staffs and personnel. He brought up the fact that they have a huge support staff. And he was defending it. Not that we called him out on it, but he felt the need to defend it. He said, listen, what people don't understand is that my support staff is made of people that I want to get to know. Steve Sarkisian is his offensive coordinator now. He said the hardest thing for a head coach to do, especially when you've been a head coach for a while, is to get to know others in the industry when it comes to assistant coaches and fill those spots. He said when you're an assistant, you know the other assistants. You know who's good. You know who works hard. You know who is a great recruiter. So a lot of these analyst positions he uses in that way. Remember Steve Sarkisian had one of those when Lane Kiffin was the OC. Run deep on the left side for McClellan. And he's finally forced out of bounds. He used Mike Groh as an example, who was an Alabama GA in 09, and then came back to be a wide receivers coach a couple of years later. He said, I want to get to know these guys. I want to know if they're good coaches. And then, after they leave, they can come back, and I know whether or not they'd be a fit on this staff. And it's really fascinating the way he uses those spots.
And also, if before they left, they had and were exposed to either the offense or the defense, the scheme, the terminology. When they leave, they take some of that with them. And so when they do, and if they do come back, as Steve Sarkisian did and others have, they're not rewriting the playbook, right? Saban doesn't want to do that. What we do is what we do. Yes, he's open to making adaptations, and he's done that better than anybody and been open to that better than anybody. But the system is the system, and we'll make changes that fit our personnel. And that's why I think they've been so successful, you know, turning over the coordinator positions, because a lot of that terminology and schematics and philosophy stays the same.
Obtaining information and expanding your network is what that told me about Nick Saban right there.
Yeah.
Sark was an analyst in 2016, went to the Falcons for a couple of years as the offensive coordinator. And he talked to us about his development as a coach. And Jordan, it was really interesting hearing him talk about the fact that sometimes in this industry, when you rise so far, so fast, you kind of lose who you are and who you should be. And whether it's ego or whatever, sometimes you can get out of control.
Yeah, I think you lose a sense of reality in a way, and I think you end up being never satisfied. I mean, all these successful coaches are of kind of the same personality. They're grinders. They have high aspirations. They're supremely confident in what they do. And when you rise so fast and you're so used to that, you lose sight of what's important at times. And Steve's had his ups and downs on and off the field in his coaching career, but you know, he said humility was something I have really had to learn. And that's one of the things that I take to heart and I've learned here under Nick Saban. And I've learned, too, that you have to work on yourself, right? I need to be the best Steve in order to be the best coordinator. And sometimes it takes a reset button at times to do that. But you're seeing an unbelievable play caller and an unbelievable person right now in Steve Sarkisian. I think that's why his name continues to get thrown around for head coaching vacancies.
Cole, when you're on a staff like this and you're constantly competing for national championships, it also allows you to be patient and in some ways picky to make sure that that next head coach offer you accept is going to be one where you can be successful as a head coach and you don't have to take second tier jobs even if they are Power 5 opportunities.
I don't think there's any doubt about it. And what better thing to have on your resume than being attached to Nick Saban, being attached to this Alabama program. And I think over Nick Saban's tenure, there's one thing that hasn't gotten a lot of attention that a lot of people haven't talked about is you rarely hear of an assistant that Nick Saban fired. Everyone just leaves. They all go to the next thing. Now, sometimes the next thing may be
a bit. What are you saying, that none of them get shown the door?
I'm not saying that at all. But what I'm saying is there is no public release of a coach being fired from a Nick Saban staff. They are always assisted in finding something else. And I think that's part of the respect that Nick Saban has, not only for the profession, but the guys that come and work for him. I think Nick Saban is smart enough to know that guys are already looking for the next thing. So a lot of times he'll help them find the next thing. And if he wants to replace someone, he's also going to help them find the next thing without just saying Monday morning at 7 a.m., hey, guess what, buddy? You don't have a job anymore.
Do you ever see an empty old McDonald's building?
No, but Pizza Hut all the time.
Exactly right. Because even for some reason the McDonald's does close, they're going to raise that thing so you don't drive by and see, well, they failed on this corner. You don't see any failures coming out of Nick Saban's staff, even if they were no longer a fit on his staff.
I could take you to
Jason
a jewelry
McClellan
store.
Again.
I could take you to a jewelry store on Green Springs Avenue, about 45 minutes east, and show you an old McDonald's building.
Probably more personal pan pizzas available in other buildings. 2:08 to go. Kentucky really up against it when this thing started due to the injuries. And it added to it. Tyrell Asian on the sideline in street clothes now. Without their starting middle linebacker, a couple of safeties. Another linebacker in Jackson. Here's McClellan, and he's in with a touchdown run. Right in front of Cole. You know what that play call was, Jordan? Handoff, run to the big dude in the tie.
The bright pink tie.
Don't stop till you get to Kublik.
Cole, what would you do here? You're a linebacker. What are you doing here? He's coming right at you. 21.
You break down, head back, put your face mask right in the chest, wrap up, drive your feet.
Oh, it looked like you were trying to get out of the way there. I don't know.
I was avoiding him. I don't need another surgery. Even though I saw Norman Walsh a few minutes ago, that's the last thing I need to be doing, is getting wheeled up to Andrews tonight.
Look at this. Kublik versus McClellan. Welcome back. SEC Network football presented by Farm Rich. Alabama with a 60-point lead. Basketball season is here. John Calipari's team be on the floor at Rupp. Hosting Morehead State Wednesday at 6. And then Rick Barnes and number 12 Tennessee play host to Charlotte immediately following on the SEC Network. Big Blue Madness occurred at some point. It aired last night. Isaiah Jackson did this.
Oh, what? He stepped on the line.
Yeah, weak.
I mean, still, done that before on a six-footer.
Tens across the board. He told us afterwards, he said, yeah, I'd never really taken off from that far back before.
It looked easy, too.
It looked easy. He's going to be really good. Number one recruiting class in the country. Again, for Kentucky. Joey Gatewood back in, a quarterback. After Bo Allen had some opportunities but couldn't get anything done. 17 second-half plays for Kentucky, only one first down. And Gatewood will handle the final 90 seconds. And Kentucky is entering an interesting time. You know, they have Bama here, and then they go to Florida in a week. And if all of these guys that we have crossed out of our two deeps are out because of COVID-related issues, whether that be positive tests or contact tracing, it stands to reason that they're going to be just as shorthanded next week when they go to Gainesville.
Absolutely. I mean, you can't expect to walk into a stadium against the number one team in the country or a top 10 team or any SEC team without some of your best players on either side of the ball in Chris Rodriguez, Jamin Davis, and expect to perform up to any type of standard that's going to help you play consistent winning football. Just, it's tough.
I do think it's fair to reiterate, guys, that Mark Stoops told me before the game, you know, we're planning on playing. We're going to do everything we can to play, and if at all possible, we're going to play football.
And that is a message that's been drilled into these coaches' heads, the value for their teams to be on the field, not just to the local athletic departments, but from a conference perspective as well. On third and three, and it's why Missouri's playing tonight. It's why Mississippi State has only a couple of buses rolling into Athens tonight. And that'll be an interesting one under the lights in the Classic City. All Alabama in this one. Nick Saban squad with its 96th consecutive win against an unranked team, their 30th straight against the SEC East. Bama with the win to go to 7-0. Once again, our final. Bama 63, Kentucky 3. Coming up next, it's SEC Now, presented by Yellowwood, followed by Mississippi State and Georgia. So long, everybody. Have a great night.